start there. See if we can get through verse 10 today. We're going to try to get that far. So Joshua 7, I'm going to just read the first two verses just for devotional reasons, and then pray, and we're going to get right back into part 3 of this wonderful chapter called The Agony of Defeat. As now you can hear it ring just a little bit because I'm too close to the speakers. That's the only reason why it's ringing now. But if I was to stand back further,
okay. If you turn it down, it won't ring, or you want it
there. Yes, if you, I'm gonna adjust it. There's another button.
Okay.
The level from left to right is what I adjusted because I now hear it ringing here, but I think it's ringing because I'm too close. Because the speakers really should be on the side here, or they should be in the back facing this way.
What about the microphone that you picked to yourself?
That's good. That's not the problem. The problem is the speakers, their position. They should be in the middle of the church here, or they should be back there, face this way. Like we used to have it in my neighborhood.
Yeah.
The speakers were in the back facing this way.
Okay.
Because when you're too close, when the mics are too close, it's going to ring. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Unless you got some real good system where the people can know how to really fix it where it won't do that, but
okay. They
don't have that kind of system here. Okay, so just the first two, that's the first three verses. I'm just reading the first three verses and pray, and then we get it straight into it. First three verses, chapter 7, Joshua, from the New King James Version. But the children of Israel committed a trespass regarding the accursed things. For Achan, the son of Carmi, the son of Zabdi, the son of Zerah of the tribe of Judah, took of the accursed things. So the anger of the Lord burned against the children of Israel. Now Joshua sent men from Jericho to Ai, which is beside Beth Aven, on the east side of Bethel, and spoke to them, saying, "Go up and spy out the country." So the men went up and spied out Ai, verse 3, and they returned to Joshua and said to him, "Do not let all the people go up, but let about 2,000 or 3,000 men go up and attack Ai. Do not weary all the people there, for the people of Ai are few." Let us go ahead for a word of prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you once again for being in your presence. Thank you for this opportunity to study your word one more time. As we open up your scripture, allow us to see your spiritual lesson that you will have us to learn today, that we may place it in our hearts so we do not have to sin against you, and that your word will make a mark upon us that will never be erased. In Jesus' name, amen. Now let me go ahead further and read the last two verses for this section, which is verse 4 and 5. Let's add to it, verse 4. So about 3,000 men went up there from the people, but they fled before the men of Ai. Verse 5, in this section, and the men of Ai struck down about 36 men, for they chased them from before the gate as far as Shechem and struck them down on the descent. Therefore, the hearts of the people, underline that last part, the heart of the people melted, the hearts of the people melted and became like water. The defeat of Ai. Now, Ai defeated Israel. That's when they said the defeat of Ai. Ai was smaller than Jericho. Remember Jericho, the big city Jericho, the walls came tumbling down. How is it that Israel can defeat them, but they can't beat Ai? Ai was smaller than Jericho, right? It was smaller than Jericho, defeat of Israel army. How then could such a defeat so quickly occur? How is it that 1 week they defeat a big city and the next week a little city defeats them? How is it? And did you know that this is the only passage in the book of Joshua that talks about Israel losing people to war? Only book, only passage where we read about the men dying of Israel, losing a battle. As summarized in verse 1, the root reason was, and here's the reason, you need to know what the reason is. The root reason is the sin of Achan. And we said, what was Achan sin? What did he do? Achan. What did Achan do? What was his sin? His sin was he took something from that he was not supposed to take from when they won the battle with Jericho, when they won the battle with them. They were supposed to kill everybody and leave everything. God said, don't take nothing with you. Just destroy everything. And Achan said, no, I'll go ahead and take that silk. Those silk pants over there, I'll go ahead and take that, that silk shirt. And he said he took it and hid it in his stuff, in his tent. Now, nobody knows this but God. Nobody knows this yet but God. Not Joshua, he don't know it. Nobody in Israel know but Achan and God. Now, here is the point that he's trying to bring. In these verses, we see some of the varying consequences of sin in the life of God's people. So in other words, he's trying to teach us this. Sin has many consequences, and none of them are good. Sin has many consequences. When we decide to sin, how come we don't think about the consequences? Right? We don't sin as bad. So how come we don't think about the consequences? And we still do it anyway. So sin has many consequences and none of them good. I never did a sin. I never committed a sin that will lead me into doing good all the time. Never. There's not one. So no doubt Joshua was eager to move forward for the Lord and to conquer more territory in keeping with God's directions and his purpose for Israel. But watch this. Here's the problem. Being too self-confident, they forgot to do what they did in chapter 6 so they can win in chapter 7. Let me put it that way. They forgot to do in chapter 7 what they did in chapter 6. And what did they do in chapter 6? They prayed to the Lord. They went to God about, how do you want us to do this? And God said, march around the city 7 times and blow the trumpet and all that good stuff. And they actually listened to God. Watch this. You go to chapter 7, you don't read anywhere where Joshua went to the Lord and said, how do you want me to defeat Ai? You don't read anywhere where the people went to God. They went automatically up to Ai thinking that God was going to be on their side without them consulting God. That's self-confidence. They didn't pray. They didn't seek God's plan. God could have said, I only want 5 of y'all to go up there. I can win with 5. See, they didn't talk to God. They didn't pray and seek God about going there. Watch this, another thing they didn't do. They didn't seek God enough and wait on God's hearing, because had they sought after God before they went to Ai, then God probably would reveal that there was sin in the camp to Joshua before he even went up to Ai, so he could deal with the sin problem, get the sin problem out, then deal with Ai and destroy him. They didn't do it. Joshua didn't even do it. Joshua was just as confident, self-confident as everybody else. But they still don't know what the sin is yet. They still don't know. If he had, he would not have remained ignorant of the sin. Had Joshua learned, had Joshua did it the way God wanted him to do, that means come to him to everything, Joshua would have known, because God would have revealed to him that it was Achan who had sinned, and therefore deal with Achan first, then go fight Ai. But Joshua didn't. He didn't go to the Lord. He said, let's just go on up and fight Ai. But there was sin in the camp. You got to deal with the sin first. Watch this. 4 deadly errors were the results of them not going to God. And these are the same errors that we make today. Same thing. I told you, when we look at the Old Testament scripture, we're looking at it from a spiritual point of view. If they're talking about warfare, guess what we're supposed to be talking about? Spiritual warfare. So we make the same mistakes. We can't jump down Joshua's throat and say Joshua made a mistake. We do the same thing today. The reason we fail, the reason we sin, the reason we keep messing up is because we fail to ask God's provision, his plan, his way. We fail to seek his direction. So when we fail to seek his direction, guess what we're gonna do? We're going to fall every single time. So here's the 4 mistakes that they made, that we make today. They remain ignorant of the sin of Achan. How is it that we don't know? How is it that they didn't know about the sin of Achan? That means they were not. They were not what? They were not in tune with God in what? Prayer. They were not in tune. Let's talk about the leadership in prayer. So let's bring that today. Okay, how is it that we don't know what's going on in people's lives today in our church? We should. We should be connected to each other so that I should know what kind of lifestyle you live. You shouldn't be living the good Christian lifestyle behind these four walls on Sunday, and you living this whole different lifestyle outside of Christian life that nobody here know about, but you and God. No, it shouldn't be. If you was a homosexual, I should know if you was a homosexual. I mean, living the lifestyle of a homosexual. I ain't talking about the closet homosexual. I'm talking about you living with Johnny. And yet, you tell Johnny, Johnny, you go to your church, and I'm going to go ahead and continue the Christian life. They don't know. The Christian life, you never know. Yeah, we'll find out. You see what I'm saying? There should be no known outward sin in your life that nobody in Christian life, if we are around each other enough, knows about. Some people throw that out at you. So how is it that a church can have a homosexual musician and nobody say nothing? How is that? Everybody in church know he gay. Everybody know. But ain't nobody saying nothing. Everybody know the choir director gay. But nobody saying nothing. Why is that? Yes.
Is it our place to say anything?
Yes, the scripture says it's our place to say anything, to say something. If, only if they are living, here's this is when you say something. When they are living a lifestyle of sin and not repentive of that lifestyle and think that lifestyle is okay with God, is our job as Christians to pull that so-called Christian, I'm going to say so-called right now, and say, hey, don't you know that the way you're going is the wrong way? Now, if he cuss you out and say, I know what I'm doing, now you really know. Then he might say, well, I didn't never know that in my life. Yes, yes. I'm going to give you an example, too.
Yeah, I'm with him as well. It's an opposition. What about the pastor of the church? Why he can't pull his school?
He can. Yes, he can. If he find out, that's if he knows, and that's my whole point. From the pulpit to the back door, somebody knows something. Give you a perfect example. Donnie McClurkin was a known homosexual, right? I don't know if y'all knew that. Nah.
Well, I heard that he was raped at a young age.
Yes, he told his own story. He told his own story. Now, this is what he said. He was molested as a little boy by church folks. Church men did this to him. He was learning how to play the organ and all that good stuff and everything since he was a little boy. He said this about himself, and this is an amazing testimony. He said, he's been in church all his life. Out of all those years, until he was a grown man, it was Marvin Winans that told him this first. He said he had never heard this until Marvin Winans told him. He said, I'm a grown man preaching, playing the organ, and it was until I joined Marvin Winans' church that he told me this. But before I tell you what Marvin Winans told him, he said this. He grew up in church, learned how to play the organ. He said, I was just a switcher, just a head, just everything. I had it down pat. Didn't nobody say nothing to me. Nobody said nothing to him. They knew. They knew the preachers that he said, because they were still probably messing with other people. Then he grew up into it. He grew up into that lifestyle. He said he was playing boy and everything. So he said he get to Marvin Winans' church, because you know Marvin was known for when he first started his church, everybody wanted to go to Marvin Winans' church because everybody wanted to sing. And everybody thought he about to do this album. So everybody wanted to join Marvin Winans' church because he's going to make this album. He's going to get his choir going. So Donnie McClurkin is a known singer as well. So he got Donnie over there. He got, oh man, he got his wife at that time. What was his wife's name?
Vicky.
Vicky, everybody was over there. BB was over there. Everybody was over there. BBC said all of them was over there. So everybody want to go to Marvin Miner's church. So now you got Donnie there. Donnie said, Marvin, because when Donnie joined, he said, I joined the choir and everything. And he said, I was flamboyant and everything. And Marvin pulled me to the side. He said, can I talk to you? He said, now, mind you, he's not originally from Detroit. He's from New York.
Right.
And Marvin brought him here. Pulled him to the side. Said, I'm gonna tell you something. He said, you get mad at you. If you walk, he said, men don't walk like that. That's one thing. Number two, the way you dress. He told me about my dress, and he told me about the way I was walking and the way I was acting. So from that point, he said, I had to come clean to him about the lifestyle and just, I need to be delivered. He said, but that was the first time somebody ever confronted him because everybody wanted to hear Donnie sing. They didn't care about Donnie's lifestyle. They wanted to hear Donnie play the organ. They wanted to hear Donnie sing. They didn't care about what Donnie was doing behind closed doors. Marvin was the first one. So he says when he got delivered, and that was the first time he ever told anybody that was at Marvin's church, he says he's been clean ever since and been living that lifestyle of a Christian life. And he tells everybody from now on that God delivered him from that lifestyle. You look at that man today, you wouldn't be able to tell. You wouldn't be able to tell, because he changed. That man changed totally. He's a pastor now in New York.
And he also has his own radio show.
He's very committed to Christianity, and he is not ashamed to tell somebody his testimony. He ain't care. He'll tell you where he come from. And that's the thing. So if Marvin could see it, just like you said, the pastor saw it, let me pull you aside. You say you want to be a member of this church. You want to be my friend. I brought you from New York, but you ain't going to be acting like this. I'm not. And yet, we sit here, and this is the whole point that he's bringing here in this verse. We sit here in churches, not just Christian life, but in churches knowing people are willfully sinning, and watch this, don't say anything.
But going back to his question, how do we?
How do you do it?
Yeah.
How do you do it?
Is
well,
right?
to me, you start off with the people you know, not the people you don't know, or welcome to people strangers now in the church. Let's start with your own family members. You know your family. Talk to them first. Now everybody else, you can leave up to me, or to the leaders of the church, because if you don't know them, I wouldn't want anybody to walk up to somebody that they don't know and say, I saw you at the strip club the other night. Oh, how'd you see me there? where would you sit? If you saw me at the strip, I saw you walk in. Oh, okay, you was driving by, and you saw me walk in. How you know I had to go to the bathroom? Go ahead.
But I mean, I understand what you're saying, and the Bible does say that, though, but a lot of us as human beings say we have our own issues, we have our own problems.
Right.
Who am I to be on somebody? It's like, you know, that scripture says, how can you tell your brother to get that log out of his eye when you got, I mean, beam out his eye when you got a log in your own eye?
Right. So, yeah. So take care of you first.
Right. The man in the mirror.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying. You have to take care of yourself. That's the whole point. That's the whole point of being in the church. We are supposed to be accountable to who? Each other.
Amen.
Ourselves and each other. So if I see you, I'm going to say something. If you see me, you're going to say something to me. You should not be afraid to tell me if you see me do something wrong. Even though I may not know what you've done wrong, but you see me willfully do something wrong, don't be afraid to tell me when I've done wrong, because at the end of the day, you're going to bed at night before, hopefully praying and asking God for forgiveness, just like I should be. But it's even better when I have a brother or a sister who says, listen, brother in Christ, I saw you. I saw you, and I'm not here to condemn you, but I'm letting you know that's wrong. Please bring, get it right with the Lord. Pray about it. I'm just letting you know. Now, do the pastor know? I know I got to tell him, right? Because you're the deacon of the church. You know I'm going to tell him. You beat up your wife. You know I'm going to tell him. You molest the kids. You know I'm going to tell them. You see what I'm saying? It'd be crazy if you knew a guy was a child molester, and yet you didn't say nothing in the church. And then I got to find it out on TV. And I just ordained him to be a preacher. It has happened. It has happened over and over again in these churches. Somebody knows something. So before we put ourselves out there, oh, I'm such a Christian. Okay, I'm gonna hold you accountable to what you say. If you say you're a Christian, that means you're telling me you're walking by Christ, or you're trying to. So what is it in your life? That means we gotta be transparent. We gotta be so transparent. I wouldn't be offended if I'm not trying to hide something. Why am I offended? Because Brother Promise came up to me. What am I trying to hide? I want to get rid of my sins, right? So if I want to get rid of them, my behavior, if I expose myself, it's a good thing that he saw me, because I exposed myself, because he's going to challenge me, and then that helps me for him challenging me to learn better, to do right better the next time. But if he never says nothing to me, and you never say nothing to me, how do you know if I know what I'm doing is right or wrong? No. We do our children the same way. When you raise kids, you don't let just kids do whatever they want to do in your house. You just don't do that. You correct them. We have to do that. This is what they feel. Here's the thing. This is what he's saying they failed to do. We're supposed to be so close knitted together like Israel was to God that they were supposed to know all their sin in the camp before we even go to Ai. But see, here's the problem. They did not know because they thought they had it in the bag. I don't need to call on God. I don't need to pray to God. We're going to win this battle. We won the last one. We're going to win the next one. We do the same thing. Here's the second thing. They underestimated the strength of the enemy. Do we do that today? Do we underestimate the devil?
All the time.
We got to remember, Satan is not a human being. He's a fallen angel. As a matter of fact, angels are more powerful than us, whether they fallen or good. They're powerful than we are because we are physical and they are already spiritual. Just in that fact alone, we cannot handle what they could do. So guess who we got to call on? We got to call on God every single time. I never underestimate the devil, because one victory you win by him today, he's not going to quit. Just because you beat him up yesterday don't mean he's going to let you beat him up today. You got to do the same thing you did yesterday to beat him up. You got to do it today, tomorrow, the next day. You got to do it every day. And the day you decide that Satan is tired of you beating up on him is the time he knocked you out. That's the day you say, oh, got me a left hook in. See, you relax. You thought I was hurt. The devil, I ain't hurt. You got to keep beating him until Jesus comes. Yes, sir.
You remember when we funeralized somebody at Worldwide. Mm-hmm. And a guest organist came in. This man, dark skin guy, he was, you know, sang.
Okay.
He had mascara on his dog. And, kept on watching him and the mannerism and stuff, not outwardly, but you sense stuff, and he was playing, and so a couple of his, I guess they were church members, but they sat in the back, and it was a guy.
Okay.
He had on a little mink jacket.
Okay.
Perfectly manicured. I was watching him from the back, looking at his skin, I was trying to see if it was one, but it was, and she was cheering him on, they were together, but he came from a reputable church. You guys knew him.
Okay.
I don't know his name, but you got to know him. Because he sung, he played at the funeral, he played a song, and he sung. He was there, I think he had on a black robe. It was very dark.
I think I know him.
But he was that way.
Was he a gospel singer? Was he a gospel singer or a known gospel singer in that area?
And he was known, but from a church, or somebody who affiliated with the church, or from gospel, or world of gospel.
Okay.
But he was playing, and he got everybody up, and his two friends came in, you can see how they were, and y'all playing, I'm saying. Evidently, which is what the church they were from, and mm-hmm. the church allowed it, I mean, just the fact that he sat up there, people know.
They know.
And from a standpoint of a person in that position, a pastor has to know. Because yes. he's a head choir or head organist or whatever, you see it. So,
right.
Don't the responsibility also allow me, they're not just the members, but the pastor too?
Yeah, but here's the point. If it's a funeral and he's a guest, you can't stop the guest. Now, unless he's unless the pastor called him in to play for the funeral, now I got a question. You see what I'm saying? Was he playing for the funeral, or was he a guest to sing at the funeral?
I don't remember.
If he was at Worldwide, he wasn't a guest.
Okay.
He was a guest to sing, I guarantee you. Okay. If he was at a funeral, he was a guest to sing there. He wasn't running, he wasn't the musician of the funeral itself, because that means the pastor would have had to hire him. You know, Cunningham, well, I don't know, would have hired him at the lateness of the hour. Some people will hire anybody at the lateness of the hour to run a funeral service.
People get caught up in the popularity of the name, God, you know, who they are, you know, because they say, oh, that's such and such.
They do.
They use the term like, oh, they're anointed. You know, as though, you know.
Anointed to do what?
I'm just saying, because they sing.
Right.
They do what they do. But to do that in a church, I mean, that's just counterproductive.
To override the sin.
Right.
To look beyond the sinful lifestyle, even bring your guests and your friends to flaunt it that way. I don't know if you remember the twins from Craig Memorial. What was that boy's name? You just started thinking about them? Oh, I forgot their name.
The Craig Brothers.
Not the Craig Brothers, but remember the two guys that come with the Craig Brothers, you know, both of them passed too. But they used to go to all the concerts. We used to know these big guys used to go to all the concerts. Every concert, wherever we went to, I was like, they always showing up at every concert we went to. And they would come in with fur coats and all the stuff, and then they would lie. They bring their friend, they bring their entourage, and they playing the tambourines too loud. And I was like, they wanted the attention. They wanted that attention. But, you know, we was young, we were teenagers then, so we didn't understand that they had this entourage with them. And as you said, they bring the entourage with them anyway. So it may not be the church that they went to, it just be that the fact that they are following other people. I've just found out that people follow gospel, these gospel singers, some of them follow Karen, they love Karen, they want to be Karen Clark's twin sister. And they follow them left and right. And you can't say because they all at Drew Shear's church that he don't teach against it. It's just that she's so popular that they want to be like her and follow her. They don't care what he said in the pulpit. They don't care. We just want to follow. We want to be like him.
Talk
yes.
About you know the people. Let's go there about Craig Moore. I heard about Craig Moore because Brian plays there at all the concerts.
Okay.
So he asked the Oakland Airs to sing there one time. So I've never been there. Here, when I say I went there, you look to your left, you got that. You look to your right, you look in the back of your
everywhere.
And I was just like,
you was comfortable.
I was so uncomfortable. I'm like, ooh, if they don't hurry up, I'm gonna call out choir because I'm gonna run out of here. So what? I went in there. I didn't understand. I mean, old and young.
Yeah.
And so to say all that. The preacher there, that's the Craig Brothers Church.
That was the Craig Brothers Church. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All in the world, you see all these, and he just allowed them to come in.
Now, wasn't it brothers, they were the pastor and co-pastor, or were they? I don't know. Because they weren't married? I don't know. You see what I'm saying? You never know.
And so I don't understand how in the world these people can come in there and pastor knows. Going on.
Because as
when I left, if God come back, and it was awful. I thought I'd never go back
there. Well, and here's the whole problem. I see your hand. Here's the whole problem with that. People get so, and I think Reverend was saying this, people get so in tune with the popularity of the singer or the world that they tune everything else out. They tune the sin out. As they did here in chapter 7, and said, oh, at least they're singing for the Lord. At least they said, we ain't gonna worry about that, we're singing for the Lord. No, you know what was right is right. Just because somebody's singing to the Lord don't mean they're singing really for the Lord.
When you're coming in there with all rings on your hair, late Friday and late to the side, and you got rings here, and
your friend right there next to you.
Right, and so. You have to say
something. That's a mockery. You think, to me, it would be a mockery. But to some people, which they haven't received the truth yet, as far as understanding what God's word says, it's going to be a while for them to pull away. But some of them like it. They want to be a part of that. Yes, sir.
Yes. Well, you think that's some, these two ladies, when they went to a gathering, they fell in love with each other, and they both was married, had two husbands, both of them had a husband and kids, and they divorced their husband, they both got married, and they run a Catholic church.
Together. Well, we heard it all. Yeah, but yeah, Catholicism does not ordain or condone homosexuality at all. They are totally against it. So they cannot start a Catholic church under the diocese of the Roman Catholic Church. They are not accepted as a Catholic church. Either they call it, I don't know what name they call it, but well, they can't call it a Catholic church.
You know what, the part that I seen, I can't really knew the name of this and all that, but I was just watching it, you know, the situation. So maybe I could be wrong as far as the church, but I know it has to do with the Catholic, but far or as the church, could've... but I just know these two women left their husbands for each other. Mm-hmm. I know that to be true.
There are other denominations, the Episcopalian Church, there are other denominations who call themselves Christians that do ordain homosexuals as preachers.
Oh, you got gay Catholic pastors?
No, you don't. You don't have them. You do not have a homosexual pastor in the Catholic Church who admits that he's a homosexual pastor. He's not going to admit to it. Because the Catholic Church does not ordain or condone homosexuality. They do not. They do not ordain. Not Catholics. That's Episcopalian. Not the Catholic Church.
What's next to Catholics? Because I could have swore they
Episcopalian, Methodist, Lutheran. You have those who are almost like Catholic churches, but the Catholic Church are totally. They are against abortion. You think they're going to be for homosexuality?
I'm going to check that out, but I could have sworn.
No, Catholics do not. Yeah, they will not ordain. They want their priests and they want their nuns to be what?
Celibate.
No sex.
Right.
At all. So they would never ever condone a man or woman ever talking about they're going to be a preacher in their church at all talking about sex, let alone be talking about getting married. You can't do that. You can't get married in the Catholic Church if you want to be a preacher for them. So that these two people, whoever did this, either try to start their own religion under the name of Catholicism, but they are not recognized by the church at all, that particular denomination. But that goes to show you, people do whatever they want to do. Now, third thing, so watch this. They remain ignorant, they underestimate the enemy. Three, they overestimated the strength of their own army. We can overestimate ourselves by saying, I'm going to win this battle just because I won the last battle. No, that's not necessarily so. Because if you don't do what you did in training and keeping your mind straight and your body straight for any type of battle, then you're going to lose. And it could be a smaller person. It could be a person younger than you, older than you, don't matter. And the last thing that they did, because we got 5 minutes, they presumed on the Lord. They took him for granted. See, they thought just because they won in chapter 6 that they were going to automatically win in chapter 7. That's what they thought. They thought they were going to automatically win. How can people today presume on God? How can people today take God for granted today and presume on him? How do people do that today? Could we do it today by God gave me a job and then I don't show my life or live my life for him through my job, meaning that I don't give my finances to the church. Now, God bless me with the church. Don't preach on that today. God bless me with this job, but I ain't giving him nothing because he's going to take care of me anyway. That's taking God for granted because it's God who gave you the strength, right, in your right mind to work anyway, because there's some people who can't work, who want to work, who can't work, and yet God bless you with this job, and you mean tell me you can't give him anything? That's taking God for granted. Or taking my body. He gives me the health and strength, and I take this body and do what? Do whatever I want to do with it. I'm taking who for granted? I'm taking God for granted. Because I could be one of the ones laid up in a hospital with a feeding tube in my nose and in my stomach, right? I could be right laid up in a coma. But God allowed me to live every day. We cannot take God for granted. So watch this. knowing this now about them and about us, 24, we know now that when we sin, we're supposed to do what?
Ask for forgiveness.
Acknowledge it. Acknowledge it. If you don't acknowledge the sin right then and there, what you hiding for? Either you don't accept that it's a sin, or you don't believe that God is going to hold you accountable for that sin. I understand why Christians won't ask God for forgiveness. It's First Sunday today. Why should I have to say every first Sunday, ask God for forgiveness of your sins before you partake of the Lord's table? Why do I have to say that? Now, it's been 30 days. You mean to tell me you ain't asked God for forgiveness in 30 days? If the day that you sin is the day you're supposed to ask God for forgiveness. Let me give you some reasons why people won't quickly ask God for forgiveness when they mess up.
They don't want to change.
That's one reason. They don't want to change. If they don't want to change, that kind of lets me know that they're probably not saved anyway. So give another reason why, let's say a saved person is not too quickly to ask for forgiveness. One right there. They feel in their heart they're gonna do it again. Two, God ain't he tired of listening to me. He ain't gonna hear me. That's two things. So watch this. So once again, we get why, well, it's a good thing that you have some kind of remorse, some kind of depression, some kind of that's hitting your heart about your sin, because the day you don't have that, then either your conscience is sheared like a hot iron, or you're not saved in the first place. If you can sin and don't feel bad about it, something is wrong somewhere. So I like the remorse, but we got to realize, and this is what they did too. Once they realized that they had sinned, guess what? The first thing they thought about, oh, okay, God ain't gonna, he done gave up on us. We do the same thing. We cannot jump on the Israelites because we do the same thing. When we sin, and the reason some people don't ask for forgiveness, just like she said, is because when we sin, we think God gave up on us. He ain't gonna hear me no more. He tired of me. I did that last week. I did it 2 weeks ago. I did it last month. I did it 5 years ago. So God is not going to forgive me. Now, where does that say that in the Bible, that God will never forgive you? It don't say that. He will always forgive.
We gotta realize that His thoughts are not our thoughts.
His ways are not our ways. As high as heaven is from the earth, that's how far God's ways are from your ways. The Bible says, as far as the east is from the west, that's how far God's ways are from your ways and my ways. Here's another thing. God is not a man that he should lie. So once again, if God said he gonna forgive you, he will what? Forgive you. The question is, you, as he stated, you recognize the sin. After you recognize the sin, what are you supposed to do? I recognize it, ask for forgiveness, what do I do after that?
You're supposed to change, but sometimes change don't happen overnight.
Don't happen overnight, but you start the process of trying to say, wait a minute, I got to recognize when this thing try to attack me again. I got to put some processes together to help me recognize, because if it happened for the 100,000 million time, I know 1,000,001 is coming. It's coming. So what can I put in place for me to face what I always face all the time? This is not my first rodeo. I keep going through this thing over and over and over again. So there's some processes that you gotta put in place after you ask for forgiveness. And guess what? You gotta stay before the Lord. That's one thing you gotta do. You gotta stay before the Lord. It's 10 minutes after you pass the plate around. Give me 5 more minutes and we are done for this today. Such is not wise, only unwise, but it is often causes us to be insensitive when we don't ask God for forgiveness. It leaves us defenseless against the enemy because we are operating in our own strength and our own wisdom. Ultimately, then these failures stand in the way of our progress and ability to handle the various challenges in life. When you don't ask for forgiveness and conquer and challenge that sin, guess what you're gonna do? You're going to be like that in everything that you do. Finally, watch this in verse 5. We're going to close with this part, verse 5. So the hearts of the people melted and became as water. The heart of the people melted. The defeat of Ai was demoralizing to them. That little city beat us. They had a whole 3,000, it was only 36 of their men, had 3,000 men running. They beat, this little city beat us. So it was demoralizing. Rather than examine, watch this, rather than examine their own hearts, guess what they did? We said this earlier, they gave up. See, when defeat comes, because remember the lesson's called Agony of Defeat, when defeat comes, you don't run and hide and give up. You're supposed to turn to the Lord. What's the defeat in our life? Sin. That's the defeat. So when sin comes and we sin, we don't run and give up. We're supposed to run toward God and say, God, forgive me one more time and allow me to get these processes put in place that I sin not against you again. I believe that the process of always being before the Lord and not relying on your own strength will cause you to have victory every single time the devil attacks you. Two things you got to do every day. You're supposed to be praising God every day. You're supposed to always keep God before you in your mind. If the devil don't stop throwing things in your mind, then you need to counteract his thoughts with what? Praise. Praise toward God. That's the only way we could defeat the devil. The scripture said, Jesus always said, when the devil attacked him three times, Jesus said what? It is written. It is written. It is written. If you don't know the word, then how can you defeat the devil if you don't know the word? And you got to recognize the devil when you see him come. Because the Bible says, Jesus said this and Paul said this, the devil doesn't come upon us unawares. He don't sneak up on you. He can't. He can't catch you off guard. We willfully sin. Because we're supposed to be in this Bible so tough, we're supposed to know right from wrong. We are supposed to know God's way. If we don't know God's way, then what are we studying? Kirk Franklin's songs, that's what we studying? If we don't know right from wrong, and we know, we have to know God's standard. We got to know marriage is between a man and a woman. I don't care what nobody say. That's what you got to know, because God says marriage is between a man and a woman. I don't care what the president says. I don't care what the Congress say, what the Supreme Court say. We don't care what no other religion say. We don't care what nobody say. We care what the Bible says. God created marriage. And he didn't put two men together. He didn't put two women together. And anybody can say whatever they want. They can say they're in love. You in lust. You ain't in love. You don't even know what love is. If you think love is actually more than just a word, it's more than saying something. Love is an action word. Love is, when you people talk about I'm in love with somebody, when you say you're in love with somebody, you're really saying you're dedicated to that person. That's all you're saying. But even if you were dedicated to the same person of the same sex, guess what? God didn't ordain it. Because God didn't, he didn't call you, he didn't do that. I love the story Dr. Miles Monroe said. He said this, him and his wife went out to dinner one night before they left. They told their daughter, clean the kitchen. We want you to wash the dishes, clean the whole kitchen, make sure the kitchen is clean. When we come back tonight, we want this kitchen clean. She said, okay, daddy, you will clean the kitchen. And then they went out to dinner, came back. No, they had a back door. You had a side door to the house. When you come through the side door, you're coming into the kitchen. So he said, we walked up in the kitchen. I mean, the floor, spick and span. Man said that floor was clean. Said, look to the kitchen table, it's clean, everything was done. He said, but I looked over to the right and looked into the sink, all the dishes was piled high. He said, piled high. So he called his daughter, they said, girl, come here. Didn't we tell you that when we left here, we wanted the kitchen clean? and the dishes were. She said, I cleaned the kitchen. He said, you mopped the floor and you cleaned the table, but what about the dishes? He said, now you did a good job. You did a good job with the floor and the table, but what about the dishes? You still didn't do what I told you to do. The problem with people when it comes down to listening to God, when we talk about same-sex marriage, when God says marriage is between a man and a woman, is you can have all the feelings in the world. Your feelings don't set standards. Because somebody can be in love with their dog. Somebody can be in love with little children. And you came in, and as a matter of fact, they say the same thing. That they are love and love and love. I just love them. That's why I got to. No, you can't marry a 5-year-old. I don't care. You 45. You ain't gonna marry no 5-year-old. What country? In some country might let you do it, but this country says no. That's wrong. So the whole point is people try to make up stuff because they say they in love with it. But what about what God says? That's all you need to realize. Say, wait a minute. All right, I know what my mind is saying. I know what my body is saying. But what is God saying? That's all you got to remember. And I'm going to go what God says instead of what my mind says, instead of what my body is telling me, I'm going to go with what God's word says. Now, why would I say that? Why would I do that? Why would I go what God says instead of what my mind and my body says? Why would I do that?
Because you're supposed to follow your mind, not your body.
No, but I'm going against my mind.
Are you saying you're going against your mind?
I'm going against my mind and my feelings. And I'm going to go with the Word of God. Why would I do that?
Because the Word of God is truth. The Word of God is life.
Because number one, we are what? Born in sin. I can't trust my mind. I can't trust my feelings. I'm born in sin and shaped into iniquity. My mind doesn't know what's right and wrong. My body doesn't. My body will go with the flow. My body goes with what, if I allow it to, it will go with what the mind says, and the mind will go with what, if I allow it to, go with what culture says. But my mind don't go with what culture says. My mind goes with what the Bible says. Therefore, if my mind is lined up with the Bible, guess who got to follow? My body got to follow. My body don't tell me what to do. I tell it what to do. That's what we got to really realize about God's word. So next week, we'll go a little bit further, verse 6 through 9, as we continue with understanding sin and how to expose it. Joshua is going to do something next week that he's going to ask God for forgiveness of not recognizing that he should have came to him first about this war before they went to war. And then God's going to tell him, yeah, and they're sin in the camp. Any other questions, comments about the lesson as we close? But we thank God for this wonderful chapter, The Defeat of Ai. Let's bow our heads. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you once again for allowing us to be in your presence. Thank you for these, your children, who have come to hear your word. Thank you for understanding that failure is not the end. We got to expose sin. We have to. In ourselves and in our brothers and sisters, if we love them, we got to tell them what's right. We have to let them know that no, God doesn't want us to walk that way. He doesn't want us to talk that way. He doesn't want us to live that way. Not only do we tell them, we got to tell ourselves first. And therefore, before we tell them, we tell ourselves, and we line up with your word each and every day. Allow us that holy boldness to do it. Allow us to go before you in grace and expose ourselves, because you see it all. You see us and you see everything. As we move to the next part of our service, allow us to continue to praise your name. In Jesus' name, amen.